If you have a Bible this morning, I want to invite you to turn with me to 1 John chapter 1. Maybe you brought a Bible with you. Maybe you want to use one in the pew or the chair in front of you. But we're going to be in 1 John chapter 1. We're actually going to look at the end of chapter 1 and into the beginning of chapter 2. We're in a series through the book of 1 John. We began it last week and we talked a little bit about just the nature of this book. This was a book or a letter written by the Apostle John, the disciple of Jesus Christ, to some churches, probably, maybe a group of churches, a network of churches, probably in the region of Asia Minor, which is now modern-day Turkey. And John writes this that the people who are believers in Jesus, people who are part of the church, would continue to believe in Jesus. He's writing to clarify what is the truth about Jesus. He's writing to exhort them to continue on, to assure them that they have salvation and they can continue to walk in fellowship and in following Jesus. And probably part of the impetus of this letter writing to these churches in this way is that there were some false teachers who had started to stray from the truth, started to move away from that gospel, that good news of Jesus Christ, some of those core beliefs about who Jesus is. They began to not only move away, but they began to deceive others and encourage others to walk away from the truth of Jesus as well, to not live according to the way that Jesus had called them to live. So John is writing this as really a father in the faith to beloved children, as we'll even see, he refers to them here at the beginning of chapter 2. Encouraging them to continue in what they know, to have assurance for what they believe, to continue to walk in the light, as he says today. What we'll see is that some of the themes from last week, as he talked about how Jesus has come, fully God and fully man, to bring us into fellowship with God and with each other, and to give us the fullness of joy, we'll see that some of those themes continue today, but we'll see that the focus shifts a little bit. Whereas last week, John was focused on speaking about Jesus as the word of life to now calling us to walk in the light, in fellowship with God and with each other. So let's read 1 John chapter 1. We'll start in verse 5, read to the end of the chapter, which is verse 10, and then we'll read the first six verses of chapter 2. 1 John 1, starting in verse 5. This is the message which we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. The blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. Starting in chapter 2, verse 1, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. You know, in the opening verses, John spoke about fellowship with God and with the people of God. And it was primarily centered around a doctrine, the doctrine of Jesus's incarnation. That central to having fellowship with God and with the people of God was to believe this important doctrine that Jesus is fully God and fully man. And John continues in the same idea here. You'll notice he speaks about fellowship with God and fellowship with God's people in these verses. But here, his focus isn't so much on a doctrine to believe, but seems more in a way to behave, if you will. It's not so much about just something that we must know or believe in, but what is necessary to the fellowship is the way that we live and the way that we act. It's important for us to grasp this because what we are called into is fellowship with God. I think it's an important part for us to remember as we just think about the Christian life. Sometimes we think about the whole kind of goal of Christianity, the whole goal of the gospel is that we would be forgiven of our sins. And make no mistake, that's an important part of the gospel. That's an important part of our salvation. Our 9 o'clock class for the month of October that is happening in the firehouse is on the doctrine of salvation. Today, Tim Wiarda was teaching about justification, which is our forgiveness, our being made right with God. But that was just week one of the class. Justification is not all there is to salvation, and forgiveness is not all there is to salvation. We are called into what John is describing here as fellowship with God and the people of God. We are forgiven that we might have fellowship. And so if we're going to have fellowship with God, then we're not just going to believe something, but we're also going to behave or live in a certain way. So he begins with a very important premise in verse 5. It's a statement that really sets up not just this passage, but the other passages to come. He says in verse 5, "This is the message which we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all." This is a tremendous statement. John seeks to make it very clear that God is light. Notice that he doesn't say that God has light or God himself is in the light, but rather God is light. Just as we will read later on that God is love, God is light. He is the source of light. And John Woodley wants to make this clear where he says, in him there is no darkness at all. In fact, in the original Greek, John uses almost like a double negative to really prove his point. Absolutely no darkness in God. Now, what does he mean by the fact that God is light? As Pastor Clark was mentioning earlier, if you read the Bible, you'll find many references to God being light. Many times it might refer to the fact that God is pure or holy. The fact that there's no darkness in all might mean that there is no evil or sin within him, that he is totally set apart. Other times, the light of God is speaking about God's truth or revelation, that we know the truth. Just as we can see in the light, we would know the truth according to God's truth, God being the light. Sometimes the references may be a little bit more broad, that God is light, meaning he is life. Just as many ways light is a source of life, God being the light means that he is life. We have to come to him to receive that life. I think one of the best ways we might know what someone means when they say God is light is to read the context. I think John gives us some idea here. What does it mean for God to be light? He primarily fleshes it out by speaking to us as the readers of this text in a call for us to walk in the light. He doesn't necessarily go more into what does it mean for God to be the light and not have any darkness, but rather he calls us as people who have fellowship with God. He calls us to then walk in the light. So what does it mean to walk in the light? Well, here John speaks about a number of things, as we'll see in just a moment. He speaks about truth, saying that if we claim to be in the light but are not, we are liars and the truth is not in us. He makes reference to the fact that being in the light, it has something to do with sin. It seems clear as he talks about confessing our sin. But I think maybe most clearly, he describes walking in the light in chapter 2, verse 1. If you look at what he writes there, I think this might be the best kind of summary statement to what John is aiming for in this section as he calls us to walk in the light as he is in the light. He says in verse 1, "My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous." See, John is writing that you are to walk in the light, and then he says, here is why I am writing to you. Here is why I am calling to you to walk in the light, that you may not sin. So we'd have to say that at least a major part of walking in the light is not sinning. Right? If he says that I want you to walk in the light and I'm writing these things to you that you may not sin, he is writing therefore for us to walk in the light in obedience to God. When he says may not sin, he is referring to the fact that we would have the ability to not sin, not like it's a maybe. This just brings up kind of a humorous incident recently. I was picking my son up from his kindergarten class, and I was just checking in with his teacher about how he was doing. She said, overall, he's doing well. He often likes to argue. She said, we recently got into an interesting argument about the pledge to the Bible. This is a Christian school, so each morning they do different pledges, and one of them is to the Bible. And part of the way that the pledge goes is that I would hide your word in my heart that I might not sin against God. And my son was saying that that might is like a maybe, like might not sin against God, but I might sin against God. So who knows how I'll do today? And she was trying to explain to him that that might is more of like the ability to, that God's word would give us the ability to not sin against God. What he's saying here is, I'm not writing so that you maybe would sin against God, maybe not. He's saying, I'm writing these things that you would have the ability. You would have the might, the maybe to not sin against God. So to walk in the light means that we would be walking in accordance with God's design, not sinning. But notice what he says next in verse 1. He doesn't say, but if anyone sins, he is kicked out of the light. Right? He doesn't say, I'm writing these things so that you would not sin. And if someone does sin, then that means that they are really in the darkness and they are not in the light. He says, if you sin. Maybe you would read that if almost as an if that's when you sin. When someone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. It seems that walking in the light involves living according to God's design, but it also seems to mean trusting in what Jesus Christ has done to cover our sins, to bring us forgiveness of our sins. Trusting so much in what he has done that we would turn from our sin and trust in him. So here's the way that I would summarize it. And this is where I would kind of put the main idea of the sermon today. I would say that walking in the light involves both obedience and repentance. Walking in the light, as he is in the light, involves both obedience and repentance. I think it's really important as we think about the Christian life, as we think about fellowship with God, we have both of these ideas in mind. I think it's really important that we would have what I would call a gospel-centered view of the Christian life. And really, I think a gospel-centered view would have both of these components in mind, that we would be walking in obedience and repentance. You know, there's some people who would say, well, you know what, listen, if Jesus has already come and paid the price for your sins, if you've already been forgiven of all the bad things that you've done and all the bad things that you will do, then what does it matter how you live right now? Why do you have to live in obedience to God's commands? Why couldn't you just live in the grace of God, knowing that God has forgiven all those things? They would really, I think, diminish the call to obedience. But I think they miss the fact that being a Christian is, again, not just about being forgiven, but about being in fellowship with God. Being a Christian is about being a person who, as we just sung earlier, has tasted and seen that the Lord is good. But by the free giving of his grace through Jesus Christ, we see his grace, we see his love, and we would say, I want to be with him. I want to be in a relationship with him. I desire to have fellowship with him and to walk with him. I desire to know him more. We cannot have a call to the Christian life without a call to obedience, because obedience is necessary for fellowship. If God would say, this is the way that I've designed things to be, this is the way I've designed your life to be and the world to be, this is how you have fellowship with me, fellowship with my people, then if we were to ignore those things and to not live in obedience of those things, then we would be ignoring fellowship with God. But what God is saying is, I have freely given you my grace, that you might see that in me is the fullness of joy. My right hand are pleasures forevermore, that you would believe that and desire to walk with me. So there is this walking in the light, walking in the fellowship of God that requires obedience. But sometimes I think we can have the idea that it's only about obedience. Sometimes we might think that walking in the light is only about not sinning. And that is a great call in some ways, that we should strive to not sin. But if that's all that we ever said, it would be a crushing message. Because each one of us knows that as much as God is working in our lives to change us, Much as we desire to be in fellowship with him and with his people, there are times each and every day where we stray from his design. There are times each and every day when we fall away from his plan for us and we do sin. And the question is, what do we do then? If it's just about obedience, then what tends to go in our minds is we think, well, I just need to try harder. I just need to improve myself. So many times we might think, well, I was saved by grace, but I'm going to keep this relationship by my own efforts, by my own ability to obey. But what John says here is, if anyone sins, it's not that you need to try harder, it's that you need to trust in what Jesus has already done. And the way that we show our trust in Jesus and his sacrifice for our sins and the fact that he is our advocate and our propitiation, as we'll talk about later, is turning from those sins, trusting in him, what I would call repentance. That we not only enter into the Christian life through repentance, but as Martin Luther once said, all of the Christian life is really repentance. That we would continue to strive to walk in obedience, and when we fail, we would walk in repentance, confessing our sins and trusting in what Jesus has already done. This is what I want you to consider as you go from here today, to walk in the light. Are you walking in the light? Are you striving to walk in fellowship with God by obeying the things that he's called you to live according to his design? But at the same time, are you trusting that when you fail, that Jesus has forgiven your sins, that God has forgiven your sins because of the blood of Jesus? Are you trusting that so much that you would turn from that sin, confess that sin, and trust in him? This is what I think we are called to walk in the light. Now, I think one of the main focuses of John in this passage is to really challenge his people, the readers, to consider whether or not they are walking in the light. And I think it's a good call for us today to really consider for ourselves, are we walking in the light? And so what he does really around kind of what I think is like the central statement in chapter 2, verse 1, is he gives a number of kind of propositions or objections that someone might bring. And what he's encouraging us to do is to really think about what we say and to really think about what we do. And so here's the way I would put it. If we're going to consider whether or not we would walk in the light, then we would need to test our claims and we would need to examine our fruit. If you're taking notes, that'll be the next place that you kind of see a blank to fill in. Really, the idea that I want us to consider this morning is, how do we test ourselves, examine ourselves to see if we are in the light? And I think what John's encouraging us to do is he's saying, hey, let's test our claims. What do we say? And let's examine our fruit. Meaning, let's actually look at the way that we live our lives. Let me just show you what I mean by this. We won't put the verses up on the screen quite yet, but if you just look in your Bible, chapter 1, verse 6, he says, if we say, or another way you could think about that, if we claim something, then he kind of gives the reasoning there. But if you again look at chapter 1, verse 8, he says, if we say we have no sin, if you go to chapter 1, verse 10, if we say we've not sinned. What he's saying here is, if these are claims, probably claims that these false teachers were making, we need to consider these claims. What are we actually saying? But then in chapter 2, he really asks us to consider our actions or our fruit. Notice in chapter 2, verse 3, he says, and by this we know that we've come to know him. He doesn't say, and by this we come to know him. He says, by this we know that we've come to know him. In other words, he wants us to see some byproduct. Some sign, if you will, what we would call fruit. Is this fruit in our lives? Or if you look at verse 5, later on in the verse, he says, by this we may know that we are in him. Again, he's saying, examine the fruit in your lives. So how do we know if we're walking in the light? Well, let's test our claims. Let's examine our fruit. So let's begin to look at the claims that John makes here, probably made by these false teachers in chapter 1, verse 6. He says, if we say we have fellowship with him, while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. So I think he's saying here, if there is someone who claims to have a relationship with God, claims to be in right standing with God, and yet they are not walking in the light, then they are deceiving. Maybe they're deceiving others because they're telling other people they have a relationship with God, but they're not actually walking in the light. Now remember, walking in the light, I think, involves both obedience and repentance. So So someone walking in darkness might be someone who just decides to not live according to God's design, but to their desires or to what the world says. Or it might be someone who strives to live in a good, maybe moral way, but yet they never confess their sins. They never repent of their sins. But notice here that the claim is that they are walking in darkness. I don't think this means that this is just someone who sins. If you're here today and you start to hear this and you start to get worried, oh man, I sin a lot. Does that mean I'm walking in darkness? Well, not necessarily. I don't think John's trying to say, well, it's the number of sins that you commit, because who could count their number of sins? I think walking in darkness means a lack of conviction over sin, a lack of confession of sin. If you are someone who sins a lot, then you're in a really good place. I think we all do that. But I think you know if you're walking in the light, is there conviction over your sin? Is there a desire to confess your sin to God and to others? Is there a desire for you to restore that fellowship with God by turning from that sin? I think he's saying these people here, they're not doing that. They're living in darkness. They're walking in darkness, but claiming to have a relationship with God. The fact is, you could find people like this in many different places. To be honest, you could find many people, I think, like this in what I would say are false churches. I think there are many churches that would claim to be Christian, would claim that they are preaching the gospel, but I don't think they're preaching the whole gospel. I think many times there might be churches who would say, yes, you can be right with God and still live in that sin and still not live according to God's word. And they are deceiving people into claiming that they are in the light when really they are just in darkness. But it's not just in these maybe false churches. I think you would also find people like this in many true churches. Churches that preach the gospel and someone would be there. Maybe they would be active in the church. Maybe they would even be a member of the church. And they would say, yes, I have this relationship with God. But in reality, they're walking in darkness, continuing to live not according to God's design, continuing to not confess their sins. He goes on to say that this is not just a deceiving of others that happens in verse 6, but he says in verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Again, John's probably bringing this up because these were probably claims by the false teachers. They probably claimed to be without sin. I mentioned last week that these false teachers probably had some type of view that the physical world was kind of beneath the spiritual world. And to have salvation with God was meant that you had this kind of mystical enlightenment, the spiritual understanding. And so they probably said, if you really had the salvation, then you would not sin anymore. And so probably they claimed about themselves that they had no more sin. Again, I think we probably would find this perspective or this viewpoint, not just in first century false teachers, but maybe even in the world today. I mean, there's many people, if you spoke to them, they would probably claim to be without sin. I'm not saying they would claim to be perfect. They would say, oh yeah, I make mistakes. I do wrong things. But I think many people, if you were just to go around San Francisco and talk to them, I think you would find that probably many of them don't find a need for a savior. They don't find a need to be saved from something, which I think is a claim that they do not really have sin in their lives. They think probably that they are good enough or living right enough, or maybe they just don't have a concept of sin in their lives, but they would probably claim that they are without sin. John says the danger of this is not that you could just deceive others, but that you could even deceive yourself, so much so that you would even make a bold claim against God. In verse 10, his last claim is that if we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. God has shown us time and time again in his word that we are sinners, that we are in need of a savior. We are in need of salvation. If we claim to be without sin, we are calling God a liar because this is what he has said. Now, my guess would be that most of the people in this room are not making probably a lot of these claims, at least really outright. Probably most of us aren't walking around saying, I have not sinned. I have no sin in my life. But I wonder if maybe if we don't make these claims with our words really explicitly, do we sometimes make these claims with our lives? What I mean is so often in the church, and I'm really guilty of this myself, so often I feel like in the church, we tend to talk about the sins we used to struggle with. You ever notice that? That so many times in our testimonies, we talk about what God has already delivered us from, what we used to have problems with. But so many times it's harder to be honest and to talk about the sins we're currently struggling with. So many times in church, it's very easy to act like we needed the grace of God back then, but sometimes it's hard to admit that we still need the grace of God today. And when we live like that, I think we are in many ways minimizing our sin. Maybe even sometimes, like John is saying here, we are outright denying our sin. But John's whole point is that we cannot walk in fellowship with a God who is in the light while we minimize or deny our sin. If we're really going to walk with him, we have to despise our sin. So that's a good question for us to consider as we think about these claims and this fruit. Do we despise our sin? And I use this kind of strong language of despise because I think what John is saying here is there's got to be some reason that you would come out of the darkness into the light. And I think part of what happens when we are moved in that direction is that we begin to see how destructive our sin is to ourselves and to the people around us. We begin to see how destructive sin is in this world, and we begin to despise it. You know, the Bible says most people stay in the darkness because they don't despise their sin. This is what John writes in his gospel account in John chapter 3, speaking of Jesus as the light of the world. He says, "This is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his work should be exposed." The Bible says we love the darkness because we don't want to have to confront our sin. We don't want to have our sin exposed by God and by his light. So what would push us into the light? I think it would be despising our sin. Now notice, I'm not talking about despising ourselves. So many times I think we can get the two confused. So many times when we start thinking about despising our sin, we start to despise ourselves as sinners. We say, how could I have done that? How could I be such a wretched person who did those things, who said those things? And the danger in this is that we'll usually just find ourselves in more shame and guilt, which usually pushes us farther into the darkness. The call is not to despise ourselves. The call is actually to love ourselves. In a proper way, we would see ourselves as people made in the image of God, called into fellowship with God, but that we would see ourselves in that way so much that we would despise the sin that separates us from God. We would despise the sin that disrupts God's creation and his design, that disrupts our fellowship with him. I think that's only when we would be willing to bring our sin into the light, when we despise it. That's the way he kind of counters the first claim. And in 1:6, he says, if we say that we are in fellowship with God, but we walk in darkness, we're liars. But he says in verse 7, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. We talked last week about how we are called not just into fellowship with God, but also with each other. We have to come to grips with the fact that we can't really be in true fellowship with each other if we are concealing our sin. If we are hiding things from God and from each other, I don't think we're living in true fellowship. He says, if we're going to walk in the light, confessing our sins, repenting from our sins, that's when we experience true fellowship. How many of us miss out on the true fellowship with God and with his people because we don't despise our sin enough to bring it into the light? Listen, I know that it can be scary to talk about your sin, to confess your sin. Sometimes the most scary place to do it is at church because you just assume the people at church are judgmental. Maybe you've experienced that at times. But I would say that for you to experience the true fellowship that God has for you, you have to be willing to trust the people of God, that they would display the grace of God. And I would say, church, let's be a safe place for people to confess sin. We shouldn't be a place where we are comfortable with sin, but we should be a place where we are comfortable with confession of sin. We should be a place where people can bring things into the light and they can experience the grace of God real time in our reactions and in our words and the way we walk alongside of them. Do you trust the people of God to confess your sins? Do you trust the blood of Jesus to cleanse you from your sin? So many times people struggle. You don't know what I've done. Do you believe your sin is greater than the blood of Jesus? Bible says, where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more, that his blood is greater than all of our sin. So what should we do? In verse 9, he says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is what I mean. Obedience, yes, striving to live in accordance with God's design, but despising our sin enough that we would not just try to cover it up, but we would confess it. I've always heard it said that if we try to cover something up, God's going to eventually uncover it. Things will be found out. But if we are willing to uncover it, if we are willing to confess it, by the blood of Jesus, God will cover it. Do we believe this? Do we despise our sin enough to bring it into the light? But you know, I think that's the push that we need, if you will. There has to be a pushing from the sin side, that we would despise our sin, that we would not want to remain in it. But I think there also needs to be something that pulls us into the light. And that is the trust in our Savior, the love of our Savior. So the question is, do we despise our sin? But the other question is, do we love our Savior? What would pull us out of the darkness into the light but to trust the fact that Jesus is the friend of sinners? The fact that Jesus already knows all those things that you are trying to hide in the dark, and yet he loves you still. Jesus already knew all the things that you were going to do, and yet he laid down his life for you. Does the love of Jesus pull you into the light? This is where I think we can start to look at the fruit of our lives. Why would we obey? Why would we seek to walk in fellowship with him? It's not just because we're trying to prove ourselves or because we're trying to show that we're good enough or keep God's favor. It's because we love him. Do we love our Savior? Does it show up in our lives? He says in chapter 2, verse 3, by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Again, you'll notice he doesn't say, by this we come to know him, by keeping his commandments. We don't come to know God by our own efforts, by our obedience. We come to know God by faith, by the grace of Jesus Christ. But how do we know that we've come to know him? How do we know that we've really tasted and seen that the Lord is good? We desire to walk in fellowship with him. We desire to live in obedience with him. Do we love our Savior so much that it would draw us into wanting to walk in this way? Not only does the love of Jesus for Jesus draw us in, but it grows in us as we walk in him. Do you notice what he says in verse 4? Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. This phrase, he says, whoever obeys him, keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected. People are kind of divided on what exactly is this talking about. Is this the love of God for me? Is this my love for God? Maybe it's not too important to distinguish, but I do think it's probably speaking somewhat of our love for God. That the more we walk with him, the more we obey him, the more we have fellowship with him, the more we will love him. Isn't this true of any relationship? The more time you really spend with someone, the more time you really communicate with them, you find your love for them growing. Ask anybody who's seen a relationship dissolve. Maybe it could be a marriage relationship. Maybe it could be a friendship. Almost all the time I found that the reason that it dissolved was because they did not spend that time together. They did not really invest in each other. There was no real fellowship together. What he's saying here is if we love our Savior, the way that we grow in our love, the way that love has grown even to perfection, is that we continue to walk in fellowship with him. Does the fruit in your life show that you love your Savior? This is the call, I think, for us. How do we walk in the light? How do we keep obeying and repenting? By keeping our eyes on our Savior and his love. I just want to draw our attention to the beginning of chapter 2 as we close, as I think John is helping us to see here the love of God towards us, the love of our Savior, that we might grow in our love for him. He says, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin, but if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. It says Christ is our advocate. An advocate is one who supports. An advocate is one who gives voice to those who have no voice. He says, the reality is each one of us are sinners. And so many times we want to just advocate for ourselves. I don't know if you've ever found yourself doing this, where you start to justify your behavior. You start to defend what you said or what you did. You blame other people. You blame your circumstances. What the Bible is saying is you don't have to be your own advocate. Jesus Christ, the righteous one, is your advocate. He looks at you in your sin and he says, I'll vouch for him. He looks at you and all that you've done and he says, I'll speak up for her. He is our advocate before the Father, our intercessor. How can we look at him as our advocate and not love him? And he goes on to say in verse 2, he is the propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Propitiation is one of those big theological terms. It really means the satisfaction of wrath or judgment by a payment. What he's saying here is Jesus is not just one who can speak up for us, but he has every reason to be able to speak up for us because he paid the price for us. Jesus can advocate for you because even though he was righteous, he took on our unrighteousness and our shame, and he bore that in his death on the cross. Jesus can forgive us of our sins because he paid the price. He took on the judgment that we deserve. He can cleanse us because he entered into our uncleanliness. How can we look to this one who is the advocate for us, the propitiation for us, and we not love him? So the call to walk in the light is a call to keep our eyes on the Savior who has loved us. As we look to him, will we not despise our sin, seeing that it was our sin that put him on the tree? It was our sin that drove the nails through his hands and feet and the spear through his side. How could we look to him and not despise our sin, but how could we look to him and not love him? The fact that he loved us while we were still sinners. The fact that he is even now advocating for you, even now interceding for you at the right hand of the Father. There's a book that I read a few years ago called Gentle and Lowly. It's just been a book that we've made available at our church at times. I still have some copies in my office if you want one. It's just always been very helpful for me since I've read it to think about the nature of Jesus Christ and his invitation to sinners. He says he is gentle and lowly at heart. And in that book, there's a chapter on 1 John 2:1 that he is our advocate. And Dane Ortlund, the author, ends the chapter by saying this: do not minimize your sin or excuse it away. Raise no defense. Simply take it to the one who is already at the right hand of the Father, advocating for you on the basis of his own wounds. Let your own unrighteousness, in all your darkness and despair, drive you to Jesus Christ, the righteous, in all his brightness and sufficiency. This is what I would hope would be the result of our time together this morning.